Good morning. It's a privilege for me to be here today to present to you about the history of soccer in St. Louis. In conjunction with the Soccer City exhibit, if you get a chance, if you haven't seen it, make sure you run through it while you're here today. They've done a great job on it. It runs through next February 18th. So if you haven't seen it yet, I really encourage you to do so. When you do these things, they always tell you to know your audience, and I'm sure there's a lot of soccer people here because I saw one person with a Tony Glavine jersey on from the old days of the Steamers. I was the beat writer for the Globe Democrat when the Steamers were here and drawing like 18,000 people a game at the old arena. So looks like we've got some knowledgeable soccer people here. Hopefully I can expand your knowledge today with today's presentation. As Charles mentioned, I've been a sports writer with the Globe Democrat. I coached at Bush Soccer Club, St. Louis Soccer Club, for about 12 years, and now I'm an author. I've written a few books about soccer, this one especially. Over all the years that I've heard and seen things about, written about soccer in St. Louis, this might be the best quote I've ever heard by the great goalkeeper for the New York Cosmos, Shep Messing. He played with and against all the great St. Louis players from the 70s and 80s. And a couple years ago when I interviewed him, he said, "St. Louis is the heartbeat of soccer in this country." That's quite a tribute from somebody who's not from St. Louis, who's from the Bronx. So if you know anybody from the Bronx, they're pretty skeptical people. And for him to say that, I mean, he said other things too. He said, like, the guys from St. Louis, they were like the 800-pound gorillas. I'd never played against guys like that. Big, fast, strong, and technical. So we're going to talk about why St. Louis is a soccer heartbeat of this country, past and present. What I like to do is start with the present, and if you, rumor has it, there's a new soccer team in town. If you saw the highlights of the first game, here's the key play from that very first game.
What a terrific ball from Moon. And now Klaus on the break. Keller across. Klaus inside. And he pokes it into the net. And St. Louis City go into the lead with 5 minutes to play. The Brazilian intent on setting yet more history on the opening night of the season for the newest team in MLS.
So it's interesting if you heard the commentator say setting more history about soccer in St. Louis. And that's what we're here to talk about today. I know there's a lot of soccer people here. Do we have any former players, coaches here? Raise your hand. Good. Okay. As I said, it's good to know your audience, and I'll explain why in a few minutes. Here's what's up for today. We're going to run through basically four parts. Why these are the best of times for soccer in St. Louis, even though we have all this great history. This probably is the best time to be a soccer fan in St. Louis. We'll talk about why in the book it says we're America's first soccer capital. And then we'll circle back and talk about the new kids in town. And as Charles mentioned, after the presentation, I'll be down by the gift shop signing books for anybody who'd like to purchase any copies of it. So let's start with why these are the best of times for soccer in St. Louis. If you watch English soccer on TV, their games are shown live on USA Network and NBC's Peacock, usually on Saturdays and Sunday mornings. If you watch the game, it was on a Friday, by the way, last February 3rd, between Chelsea and Fulham that was played in London, one of the headlines from that game was, Chelsea team worth £660 million fails to beat Fulham due to superb Tim Ream defending. Remember that name, Tim Ream. If you're not familiar with him, we're going to talk about him. Pardon me?
As a senior, I said his salary.
Yes, he does well.
I've seen him stop 9 shots.
Yes. He cleared the ball off the goal line late in the game and preserved a scoreless draw for Fulham against one of the better teams in the English Premier League, Chelsea. What does that have to do with St. Louis soccer? Tim Ream is an American from St. Louis, starting in the best league in the world, captain of the team and of the last U.S. World Cup team. That's unheard of to do all those things, to be from America, and not just from America, but from St. Louis. He's from St. Charles, went to St. Dominic High School, played at St. Louis U, and then went into professional soccer from there. And the reason why I said it's good to know your audience, when I did one of these presentations a couple months ago, his stepmom was in the audience. So I had to be careful what I said, because she would know if I was just making it up. So, another reason why we're, well, let me go back again, okay. My contention is these are the best of times in soccer in St. Louis, and that heartbeat that Shep Messing talked about is even stronger today. And here's why. Let's first of all start with the great players that have come from St. Louis just in the last 10 years. Clockwise, Vedad Abisovic, next to him, Tim Ream. On the far right in orange is Brad Davis. Directly below him is Josh Sargent. And in the middle, the two ladies are Becky Sauerbrunn and Lori Klupny, all St. Louis people who have made huge marks in the world of soccer. Let's talk about each one of them. This is this is Vedad Abisovic. He was in the first wave of Bosnian immigrants to St. Louis. He went to Roosevelt High School. He was the NCAA Freshman of the Year at St. Louis University. And right after that, he went professional. And he scored 127 goals during his career in the German league, the Bundesliga, which is one of the top leagues in the world. He finished as their 27th all-time leading scorer. So here's a guy who spent part of his time in St. Louis making his name on the national stage. He scored the goal that qualified Bosnia for the 2014 World Cup, and he also scored their first ever World Cup goal in 2014. So he's like a national hero in Bosnia. And his parents still live here, and he's back in St. Louis quite a bit. So let's watch that historic goal against Argentina.
Well, that's a beautifully weighted ball. Ibisevic has rolled it through the goalkeeper and in. And first ever World Cup finals goal. Through Romero, who would be displeased with his personal effort. But for the Stuttgart striker, and the night will be remembered globally. But his team really...
So that was a piece of history right there. He's one of the few St. Louisans who has scored a goal in the World Cup. In fact, there's only two other men from St. Louis who have scored in the World Cup, both in 1950. And a lady from St. Louis we'll talk about in a few minutes scored two in the 2007 Women's World Cup. So the next guy we're going to talk about is Brad Davis. He's from Chaminade High School, grew up in St. Charles County, played at St. Louis U. He was one of the top players in the history of Major League Soccer. Played 392 games and scored 57 goals, was famous for his deadly left foot. He made 17 appearances for the United States, including starting against Germany in the 2014 World Cup. So here's some highlights of one of his games when he was in MLS and he scored a hat trick. Watch his left foot.
Davis.
Davis, another one! Goal in the 55th and 70th minute. Now looking for the natural hat trick. Davis! So Brad Davis, he's here in St. Louis. He's the president of St. Louis Scott Gallagher Soccer Club now. Works at the soccer park in Fenton. He's one of the reasons why these are the best of times for soccer in St. Louis. We've talked about Tim Ream. You saw that video clip, and you know his reputation a little bit from what you saw. He doesn't score goals. He stops them, and he's superb at that. He's 37 years old. He's probably having the best year of his life right now in soccer. The next person we'll talk about is Josh Sargent. He's only 23 years old. He's from St. Charles, went to St. Dominic High School. He already has 23 games played for the United States and has scored 5 goals for the United States, which is number 2 all-time among St. Louis players in history. There are two players who have scored six, Taylor Twellman and Bill Luby. Bill's in the St. Louis Soccer Hall of Fame, and Taylor, as you probably are familiar with soccer, you see his face a lot on TV as a commentator for soccer games. Josh played for the United States in the 22 World Cup, and he's the only St. Louis player who scored a goal in the English Premier League, the world's top league. But he had no right to even score, so it was pretty incredible goal. The next player we're getting are the ladies, and of all the success the men have had throughout the history of soccer in St. Louis, the two most successful players internationally are women. The first one is Lori Kolupny. She's from South County, Crestwood. She went to Nerinx Hall, played at the University of North Carolina, which is the top women's college program in the United States. Their coach, who's been there since the early 1980s, said Lori is one of his top three all-time players, and he never rates one through three. That includes Mia Hamm, if you know who Mia Hamm is. Probably the icon of women's soccer in the United States, and Lori is right in that group, which tells you a lot about her. She played 105 times for the United States, more than any other St. Louisan, except the next lady we're going to talk about. The Washington Post called Lori the most complete player on the U.S. women's national team. She won an Olympic gold medal and a Women's World Cup championship, so let's watch a little bit about her.
Credit for me. What a servant Becky Sauerbrunn has been
to the U.S. There we go. There.
Credit for me. What a servant Becky Sauerbrunn has been.
Let's go back. Okay. Now.
Okay. Growing up, she was the name of women's soccer in St. Louis. She was always just leaps and bounds in front of everyone as far as the game of soccer was being played.
The shot ripped! Goal! Lori Kolupny, the St. Louis girl, with a goal there in St. Louis.
Lori Kolupny doing the job of the forwards today.
She kind of changed what a left back should be. It's not just a defender. It's somebody who can attack. It's somebody who's confident on the ball. That was groundbreaking, and she was the first one to step on this team to do that.
That goal you scored, she scored at Busch Stadium when they played New Zealand in 2015, and she said that was my all-time most exciting highlight of my career, to score in my hometown before 34,000 people. So, Lori, the next one is Becky Sauerbrunn. Of all the accomplishments Lori has, Becky has played for the United States 216 times. She's the current member of the team. She's usually the team captain. She went to Ladue High School. Her job is not to score goals, but to stop them. So when you watch these highlights, they might look kind of boring, but every time you see her break up a play, that stops the other team coming down the field, and she is supremely talented at that. In fact, she's rated one of the six top all-time defenders in the history of U.S. women's soccer. And she's a certainty to go in the U.S. Soccer Hall of Fame after she retires. So let's watch a little clip of her.
Credit for me. What a servant Becky Sauerbrunn has been for the U.S. women's national team. Sauerbrunn now at 32 years of age, twice has been the NWSL Defender of the Year.
And just so consistently good. That's the thing that I think is so hard at this level. It's one thing to be good. It's another to be consistently good. And she's just not consistently good. She's consistently great.
So all those little things you see there, every time she did that, she stopped the other team's attack. Doesn't look like much, but it means a lot on the field. So she's the last of the great athletes, great players we developed in the last decade. We've also got some great leaders who have come to the fore in the last decade. On the far right is Dan Flynn. He was the head of the U.S. Soccer Federation since the early 2000s. He retired in 2019, so he basically ran soccer in this country for almost 20 years. He grew up in North County, played at St. Louis University. He was the head of the International Beer Division at Anheuser-Busch when he got an opportunity to follow his dream and work for the U.S. Soccer Federation. In the middle is Jim Cavanaugh, who was the co-founder of Worldwide Technology. He played at St. Louis U. He was on the U.S. Olympic team. He is the guy who should be credited for keeping soccer alive in this city for the last 10 years until St. Louis City came along. When he heard the soccer park, which is the first soccer-specific facility in his country, was going to be sold, he bought it, gave it to St. Louis Scott Gallagher. so that would continue to be a soccer facility. He brought a professional team here in 2015 that played in the second division through 2020. And he is one of the minority owners of St. Louis City. And then, as you probably have heard of Carolyn Kendall on the far left, she is one of the top executives at Enterprise, part of the Taylor family, who are the majority owners of St. Louis City. And she is the head of the organization. She's the face of the team. So those are three of the top executives, leaders of the last 12 years. We've had some great teams in the last 12 years, some of you may not have heard of. On the far left, there's a team called Fire and Ice, which was a women's team based out of Belleville that played in the second division of women's soccer. They won their national championship in 2017, thanks in large part to one of their players named Kelsey Dingus from St. Louis. In the middle, Washington University's women's team won the NCAA Division III championship in 2016. That's the last championship in the NCAA won by a St. Louis team. And it was the first one since 1979 when SIU Edwardsville won the men's Division I championship. On the far right is St. Louis City II, which is the minor league team of St. Louis City. Last year they got all the way to the finals of their league when they lost in the championship game. So there are some of the great teams, great leaders, and great players, and most importantly, the new team in town, St. Louis City. And these are the best of times for soccer in St. Louis. If you were at Rode the St. Louis Wheel in 2019 and looked west, here's what you would see. Highway ramps, parking lots, not a whole lot, right? If you rode the St. Louis Wheel today and looked at that same view, this is what you would see. Oop. There we go. Stadium, training facilities, practice fields, all where those highway ramps used to be. All in the space of just a few years. The actual stadium inside looks like this. This was the first game last November when they played an exhibition game. And on their home opener on March 4th, just a quick shot. Okay, let me go back here. So if you look at where the big banners are, that's the north end of the stadium. When they built the stadium, they deliberately sloped it as steeply as they could within safety guidelines. It sloped at 34 degrees. There are no seats there. Everybody stands. The purpose is to create a wall of sound to basically make the stadium living hell for the other team. And if you've been to a game, it's pretty much living hell for the other team because they're always, the noise is just deafening. So this whole complex downtown, if you haven't been there, they've basically taken over downtown West. It's easily a $1 billion investment, almost all private money from Enterprise and Worldwide Technology. And the club is playing to the capacity crowds. Businesses down there are booming thanks to the facility and the club. So the second edition of the book tries to answer the questions of how all that has happened. And it shows how a series of events over the last 10 years led to a Major League Soccer franchise coming to St. Louis and the construction of that training facility and stadium that you just saw. So a little bit of background about the book. Came out in October. So there's something in it for everyone. There's a lot of text if you like to read. Lots of images if you like pictures. If you like numbers, there's a lot of statistical tables in the back of the book that you can study. So there's something for everyone. In fact, this is a little bit of an exaggeration, but it gave me an excuse to use the picture. The guy looking at the book is the head coach of the number one ranked world's women's team, the U.S. national team, Vlatko Andonovski. He's from Skopje, Macedonia. If you know your Steamers history, their great goalkeeper, Slobo Ilievski, was from Skopje. Vlatko knew Slobo, and when he saw Slobo's picture in the book, he was just so thrilled. And we were lucky enough to get this picture, and it gives me an excuse to use it here in a presentation. As I said, it's a good promo for the book, if nothing else. So we've talked about the present. Let's talk a little bit about the past. The story starts a long time ago. Many people, when they talk about history of soccer in St. Louis, they say 1950, that's when it all started. What happened in 1950? Yes, we beat England in the World Cup with five St. Louisans in the starting lineup. So that perception is really not true because we've been playing soccer here a lot farther than that. I wanted to use that part about 1950 just to get a quick clip of that game in the presentation. This is when the U.S. beat England in 1950. The goalkeeper on the far right is Frank Borgie from the Hill in St. Louis. The player number four wearing gloves is Charlie Colombo, also from the Hill in St. Louis, and renowned for his perhaps a little bit dirty play. No sound with this. They're carrying Frank off the field after the game because they said he, along with the guy who scored the goal, were really the stars of the game. Frank played out of his mind in that game. And even today, it's rated as one of the top upsets in the history of soccer because England was favored to win the World Cup. The U.S. players were all part-time guys. They had jobs, and they were just kind of playing soccer on the side. But they beat mighty England. And a lot of people don't realize they could have easily won that game 2-0 because Frank Wallace from St. Louis hit an open net right at the end of the game and an English player was able to block it off the line. So St. Louis guys had a lot of prominent roles in that game. So here's why we call America's first soccer capital. Generation after generation of native-born players produced in this country since the late 1800s. No other city in the United States has done this. It's primarily because of Christian Brothers College, which is today's CBC High School. In those days, they were a college. They deliberately imported religious faculty from England to teach soccer to the boys because at that time there was rugby was becoming popular in the United States. It was a very violent sport in those days. They wanted the boys to play another sport that was a little more tame. So they introduced soccer at CBC and also started introducing it in the parishes in the city. That eventually became the Catholic Youth Council organization. Almost anybody in St. Louis who's played soccer has played in the CYC. They start kids from little bitty ages all the way up through senior men. By 1966, they had almost 500 teams and 8 age groups in St. Louis, way more than any other soccer program in the United States, and it was unmatched until the late 1970s when other cities started doing the same thing. 90 national championships, that includes U.S. Open Cup, U.S. Amateur Cup, colleges, junior colleges. 77 players from St. Louis have played at least one game for the United States national team since 1916 when the first national team started. I would challenge almost any other city in the United States to make that statement. 77 locally produced players who played for their country. 34 people in various U.S. soccer halls of fame, and you'll see their names if you go through the soccer exhibit here. So let's talk about some of the new stuff in the that's come out about the old days in the last 10 years when I wrote the second edition of the book. Since the first edition came out in 2011, all the St. Louis newspapers are online now, going back to before the Civil War. So it's relatively easy to enter some search words and find stories about soccer or anything else in St. Louis. What we found in doing that research, the first report of a football game is February 7th, 1872 at 19th and Pine, which is 2 blocks from today's soccer stadium. The first game where we have reports of results was played in 1875 at what became Sportsman's Park. The first soccer league formed here in October of 1884. Why is that a big deal? The English Football League did not start until 1887. So we were playing league soccer in St. Louis before they were playing league soccer in England where the sport was born. That same year, it turns out the first international soccer game ever played in the United States was played here on Christmas Day of 1884. A team from Toronto, which is pictured on the lower left, came to St. Louis and played 2 St. Louis teams on Christmas Day and a couple days after that. That picture was taken in St. Louis in a hotel. On the far right is Ebbie Dunn. from St. Louis, pictured in a 1927 game against a team from Uruguay. He's important because he scored the goal that won St. Louis's first national championship in 1920 in the finals of the U.S. Open Cup. So, and we also in the last 10 years have found out that the oldest still existing footage of a soccer game in the United States is from St. Louis. This video was taken on March 30th, 1924 at what was called High School Field, which was the old Federal League baseball park from the 1910s and is about two blocks southwest of Herman Stadium at St. Louis U, their current soccer facility. This was the U.S. Open Cup final. This, the U.S. Open Cup is considered the national championship of U.S. soccer and continues today. In fact, there's a World Open Cup game here in St. Louis tonight at the soccer stadium. St. Louis City plays a lower-level team, Union of Omaha. So let's watch this brief clip. It goes way back in time. Again, no sound. That's Vesper Buick. That was the team from St. Louis. And the opponents were Fall River from Massachusetts. Cold day for the end of March. That's it. Fall River won the game 4-2. Vesper Buick was a Buick dealership at 3900 West Pine, and their building's on the National Register of Historic Places still. The Open Cup, let's talk a little bit about that because St. Louis has a big role in that. Won 10 championships starting in 1920 when I talked about Jimmy Dunn and Ben Miller. The last team to win was in 1988, Bush Seniors. MLS teams, once the league was formed in 1994, started playing in the Open Cups, and they pretty much dominated since then, as you can imagine. You know, the top professional league in the United States, it would only make sense that they would win the Open Cup. But we've made 21 appearances in the Open Cup finals since 1920, including perhaps the greatest team in St. Louis soccer's history, shown in the lower right, Sticks, Baron, Fuller. They won three consecutive U.S. Open Cups in the 1930s and made the finals 6 years in a row. As I mentioned, the Cup is here tonight with a third round game between St. Louis City and Union Omaha. So Sticks is one of the top teams in the history of St. Louis soccer. Some of the other ones, the picture you see is four players from Kutus. Kutus was probably the best team in the United States during the 1950s. They won six consecutive U.S. Amateur Cups, and they won the U.S. Open Cup in 1957. They're the last team to win both Cups in the same year. All St. Louis guys. On the far left is the goalie, Bob Burkhard. Next to him is Harry Keough, who was on the 1950 team, U.S. Soccer Hall of Famer. Coached St. Louis University to five NCAA championships, one of the all-time great players. Next to him is Rich Meisman, forward, and on the far right is Ruben Mendoza from Granite City. Everybody on the east side loves Ruben Mendoza because he's renowned as one of the most skillful players ever come out of St. Louis. On the far right, you'll see one of the plaques in the soccer exhibit here that lists all the St. Louis players in the U.S. Soccer Hall of Fame. So rather than me go through that whole list, you can check it out if you have time to go see the exhibit today. So let's go to part three of today's presentation, the new kids in town. We've talked about more great players, more great leaders, more great teams. And St. Louis soccer's return to greatness now in the part three of this presentation of St. Louis City. It happened quickly. You may not realize it, but they first announced they were going to try for a franchise in October of 2018. 10 months later, they had a team. The speed of that is unheard of. It's usually years before Major League Soccer gives a city a team. That gives you some idea of the financial backing and the acumen of the group that was put together to get St. Louis a franchise in Major League Soccer. If you want to learn more on that, I could say you could buy the book, but we'll talk just a little bit about that quickly to give you a little bit of flavor of why all this happened. Again, we're locally owned, again, which is not that common in Major League Soccer. We talked about Carolyn Kindle, and their financial backing is substantial, as you can see by their annual revenue. Jim Cavanaugh from Worldwide Technology, again, one of the nation's largest private companies in terms of annual revenue. So they've got that kind of pull and that kind of money behind the franchise. There are unconfirmed reports that they spent $1.2 billion on this franchise and on the facilities. Again, all their money. We talked a little bit about the complex. This was a nighttime shot of it. You have to really see it to believe it. So here's a quick video that gives you a little tour of the stadium.
Welcome to St. Louis, Missouri, known as the Gateway to the West, and now gateway to the newest club in Major League Soccer, St. Louis City SC, and their home field, City Park. This $458 million venue boasts a 22,500 seat capacity and is centrally located in downtown West, just steps away from the city's historic Union Station. Up top, the open-air stadium boasts a unique canopy design, providing supporters with some of the most extensive shaded coverage in MLS and locking in the sound and atmosphere on game day. And while this club may be the new kid on the block, St. Louis has a rich soccer heritage and an important history that the club is looking to honor and build upon for the future.
So she mentioned that the stadium cost $458 million. That's just part of the package. They spent more than $200 million just to get a franchise. They invested much more than that in the training facility across the street, where there are three fields, a team headquarters, a team store, team offices, a garage. There's a tunnel underneath Market Street that connects the stadium with the training facility. The sporting director for St. Louis City is Lutz Fahnenstiel. And he's the only person who's played professionally in all six regions of world soccer. World soccer divides the world into six regions. He's the only guy who's played in all six. So he has all kinds of connections. And he said he deliberately designed the training complex to mirror the best things he saw elsewhere. For example, and he said this is off the record, but I can tell you, he knows Pep Guardiola, who's the head coach of Manchester City, who's one of the world's leading coaches. He deliberately designed St. Louis City's locker room to look just like Manchester City's based on what he heard from Pep Guardiola and how they handle their players. Their locker room is designed in an oval. It's set up so the players are all facing inwards, so they have to look at the coach. They can't do anything else. They have to look at the coach. Very plush. The visitors' locker room looks like an old high school locker room. It's a rectangle with a pillar in the middle. And they said they deliberately did that to make it hell. It's again, make it hell for the visiting team. And they said the only people who are going to use our locker room is our team and the U.S. national team. So that tells you a little bit of the thought that went into that. The way they envision this thing is it's not just a soccer stadium. It's the Taylor family and Jim Cavanaugh's vision to make this part of a renewal of downtown St. Louis, and as a connecting point in an entertainment hub that starts at the Gateway Arch, goes west to Busch Stadium, Enterprise Center, Union Station, the soccer stadium, which connects with Harris Stowe, St. Louis U, the hospital complex, and Forest Park. So they view the soccer stadium as kind of the link that cooks all of that together. And as a boost for businesses in that area. As you may have read, the businesses around the stadium are just doing gangbuster business because people come down there not just for games, but to look at the place and to get in on away games, that come down and watch games in the soccer pubs that are around the stadium. I was telling a friend of mine, Tim Beecher, who's here, that the guy who owns Schlafly's Tap Room really lucked out. He's 150 feet north of the stadium, and the north end is where all the crazy supporters go. So guess where they go before the game? They go to Schlafly's Tap Room, raise a few pints, and they march in unison from Schlafly's Tap Room to the stadium. And he's just one of several businesses that are benefiting from all this. It's more than just Major League Soccer. They can use the stadium for other things. In fact, on April 12th, the U.S. women's team played here against Ireland. That's a picture before the game. The national team, the men's national team, will play here on the 28th. And Major League Soccer has a competition outside of their regular season schedule called the League Cup against teams from the Mexican First Division. There'll be at least one game here on July 27th. And we talked about this being more than soccer. They have their footprint in St. Louis soccer development, as well as just trying to get people to come down and pay to watch the games. This is a four-step pyramid, but there's actually five steps. They go out in the city, they have free soccer programs for kids. The ones that they think might contribute eventually become part of their academy system at age 13. They move up the ranks, if they're good enough, to the minor league team and then to the first team. So they're doing a lot of good for St. Louis, and it's also in their interest to develop players. They already found one guy named Miguel Perez. Nobody heard of this kid. He's from Pattonville. All of a sudden, he's playing for the first team, and he made the U.S. youth national team. So this is one of the first fruits of their labor in terms of developing talent. So they're interested not just in making you pay to go watch their games, but to develop that part of the city and to make more history for St. Louis by developing great players. So the guy who's the commissioner of Major League Soccer called this an unprecedented development in terms of money. I would challenge any city in the United States to match what we have today in terms of a stadium and training facilities all downtown in one place. In a lot of cities, you'll go to their MLS stadium, it's out in the suburbs. Kansas City is a good example. They're in the Kansas side, out in the suburbs. Everything here is downtown, centrally located. Now, there was some argument about why put it downtown. We have safety issues and all that. Well, you could argue about where to put it endlessly. I mean, if you put it in North County, people in South County will be upset. They thought that downtown was centrally located and the best place for as many people to get to as possible. So, for some quick background to wrap up the presentation, a little bit about MLS. The team plays 34 regular season games starting from last February through October, then the playoffs start. They sold 19,500 season tickets. They sold every season ticket they wanted to sell. They purposely left 3,000 seats available per game. Not many seats, but they sold a lot of season tickets. Their TV deal, this is probably the most controversial part of it. All their games are on Apple TV, which is basically a paywall except for some free games. Fox shows 34 free MLS games. So you have to have Apple TV to watch their games, for most of them anyway. And to go back on radio, they have an English language station and a Spanish language station. Both of those stations, by the way, are owned by the same company. I think it's Audacity. Audace, they own Camo X and they own Y98. So to kind of sum up, you know, to repeat, this heartbeat of soccer continues beating stronger than ever with great international players, great leaders, a brand new franchise, and all of this creating a future that may be even better than our storied soccer past. A little bit about, as I mentioned, we'll have the signing afterwards for anybody who is interested. You can follow me on Twitter. I have a website, soccermadeinstlouis.com, and I have a Facebook page. I post stuff every day. I post Today in St. Louis Soccer History. Today in St. Louis Soccer History, the Ambush won their league championship in 1995. There you go. The only national professional soccer championship, indoors or outdoors, won by a St. Louis team, which is hard to believe.